Good morning to all. So today we are going to discuss about the safety in demolition operation topic under construction safety, and we are going to discuss about the series of basics of industrial safety. This presentation is made by Vikrant Mirge, who is ADIS student of this year. Now let us discuss what exactly the demolition is and what are the points to be maintained under this demolition operation. So the contents for this presentation are: introduction, what is demolition, why demolition, methods of demolition, demolition sequence, hazards in demolition work, safety measures or controlling techniques for the demolition. So let us discuss one by one. So from this photograph you can understand what exactly the demolition is. Nowadays we are observing this type of operation, and the operation is called as demolition. So to demolish, to raise the building structures, some temporary structures or other construction work, that may be a bridge, that may be a chimney, that may be a tower, etc. So demolition is the operation where the raising, raking or breaking of the metal structure, the cement structure or other construction material is the demolition. So it means dismantling, raising, destroying, raking any building or structure or any pre-plan or control methods. So sometimes when the building is old, so that demolition is required. Sometimes the buildings or the structures are dangerous, then the demolition is required likewise. So depending on the requirement, we have to go for the demolition operation. So that before that, you must find out why demolition is required. So demolition is the tearing down of building and other structure. So I have discussed that some of the reasons why demolition is required. So the structures which have already passed their design life need to be reconstructed for safety and operational requirements. That is one of the major reason for the demolition process or demolition operation. The old structures need to be demolished for replacement by new structures. So old chimneys may be replaced by new chimneys, old bridges may be replaced by new bridges, old buildings may be replaced by new buildings. So for that purpose, first we must go for the demolition and then we can construct the new structure. Then what are the methods of demolitions? So demolition may be operated by hand, so with the help of hammers. Demolition may be occur with the help of ball and crane arrangement. Demolition may be by the machineries. Demolition may be by hydraulic crushers. Demolition may be by explosives. And demolition may be operated with the help of some robotic machines. So these are the different methods, and day by day the methods are varying. Some methods are added in the methods of demolition process. So let us see the methods of demolition in detail. So from this picture you can understand what exactly the demolition is by hand. So with the help of some hammers or some metallic equipment and by impact factor, you can crush the stones, you can break the walls, you can break the metal structure or you can break the bricks. So whatever the material available in that structure, that may be bricks, that may be cement mixture, that may be metallic structure, that may be some POP or wooden structures in some of the cases. So whatever the material, you have to demolish that material with the help of hammer or some other metallic equipment by impact process. So the main working principle is impacts. So depending on your metal, depending on the type of metal, the size of metal, the weight of metal, and the shape of metal, and how your hand is operated in a specific angle, on that basis that hammering process is done, and on that basis the demolition is done. So sometimes demolition by hand may consume more time as compared to other methods, but sometimes it is a requirement of that demolition process that we can't go for this demolition by the machineries or some robotic machines. So to save some material, to save some lives, we have to go for the demolition by hand in some of the structures. So this is the demolition by hand process. Then second method is demolition by wrecking ball. So you can observe this ball. So this ball is metallic ball. The shape may be changed, the weight may be changed, and that shape and the weight of metal, the matter of construction of this ball, is depends on the size of the structure. So if it is a building, then the size of the ball should be more. If it is a small structure, a small building, a row house or bungalow, then the ball requirement is less. But depending on the size of the structure, we have to arrange this type of ball and the crane arrangement. So here the crane is arranged and that ball is attached with the chain, that is also a metallic chain, and on the basis of this movement of this crane, this ball is going to strike on the building wall, and with the help of that impact energy, this steel ball suspended from the roller crane is attacked on the structural wall, and then this wall is broken. So depending on the impact energy of this ball, the time is calculated for this demolition of this building. So the wrecking ball application consists of a crane equipped with steel ball. The deconstruction of the building is by the impact energy of the steel ball impacted or suspended from that crawler crane, and one attendant and one driver is minimum requirement for this demolition method, right? Then the next method is demolition by machines. So we can use some machineries, we can use different types of machine. There are variety of machines available with the different companies, and depending on the requirement, depending on the type of demolition, you have to choose that machinery. The sequence of demolition by machine is typically the same as the top down manual method, except that the most of the demolition is done by mechanical plant. So there is a requirement, if here if you want to demolish some wall, some structure, then you can use this type of jaws, and by thrust method, by different principle, you can demolish that wall or that structure. Sometimes we have to break this metal into smaller size pieces. So that is again with the help of thrust principle, by jaws you can cut this metal pieces, and demolition can be done with the help of this machinery. So this is one of the picture, but there are variety of machineries available. There are variety of jaws, and some different working principles are available for demolition the constructions, demolishing the metals, demolishing the materials with the help of the required machineries. Then demolition by hydraulic crushers, it is the next method. So the crusher attachment breaks the concrete and reinforcements by the hydraulic thrust through the long boom arm systems. So this arm may be longer than this. So some hydraulic crushers are having more than this length for the crushing operations, so that is called as long boom arm systems. And if the height of building is more, then the requirement of this long beam is needed. If the structure like this is there, where the height of that structure is lesser as compared to the high building, then you can go through this short long process, and with the help of this short boom arm systems, you can crush the structures. The hydraulic crusher can be operated from the ground outside the building. This method is also suitable for dangerous buildings, silos, and other industrial facilities. So sometimes some silos operations where the unit operation is there, that is the solid-solid separation or solid gases separation is carried out. So for that purpose also, sometimes after a particular time duration, after satisfying the needs of the operation, we have to demolish some silos, some old structure in the industrial facilities. So for that purpose, we can use these hydraulic crushers, but the basic need is you must have some space to demolish that particular structure so that you can operate these hydraulic crushers by keeping some distance, right? Because this demolished structure, some materials and this dust is formed, and that requires some space. So the space requirement is the basic thing. Then you can go for this hydraulic crushers. So the working principle for this hydraulic crusher is the hydraulic thrust. So you can observe this jaws. So with the help of this jaws, some hydraulic pressure is created with the help of these hydraulic lines, and due to that pressure, with the help of this metallic jaws, you can crush this metal, you can crush this walls, right? And in this way we can demolish the construction. Then the next method is demolition by explosives. So nowadays this method is adopted by many developed countries because it is a simplest method. It is a less time consuming process, but it may require the more time for planning, and the cost of this demolition process is more. Now in this process, they are going to use the explosives. So we know that normally the explosive material is having the nitrogen as a major element. So nitrogen derivatives are the main materials which can be used as a explosive. So in this demolition process, nitroglycerin, dynamite, or other explosives are used to shatter reinforced concrete supports. So we can use these explosives at different locations, at the bottom, in the middle, at some particular locations, and the top also. So depending on the type of building, we have to go for locating these points where we can insert these explosives, and it is a timer process. It is a well controlled or remote control process. Linear shape charges are used to sever steel supports. These explosives are progressively detonated on supports throughout the structures. So detonation is the main phenomena under this explosion phenomena. Then explosive on the lower floors initiate the control collapse. So we have to start the explosion at the bottom side so that the all the weight or the density of this building is going toward the downward side, and the building should be collapsed at that location only, right? So it should not be tilted either side. So for that purpose, we have to blast this explosive at the bottom side first, and then naturally this density as well as this the weight of the total building should be, that is nothing but the force. Force is going toward the at the bottom or at the ground, so that the building can be collapsed in a specific manner. Ideally it should be in a vertical manner only, that is top to bottom. That is called as demolition by explosive. It is also called as implosive phenomena or implosive method of demolition. Then the next method is robotic machines. So nowadays we are avoiding the manual interventions, we are avoiding the manual error or the mistakes done by the drivers or the attendant while demolishing the constructions or the structures. For that purpose, some of the companies have developed these robots to demolish the machineries. So with the help of this remote, we can operate this jaw, we can operate this long arm, we can operate this hammer with the help of this remote only. So with the help of this some joysticks principles, we can use this hammer or jaws in 360 degree. So we can move this machinery with the help of remote also. We can move this hammer or the jaws if it is used in that robot, then that can be rotated in 360 angle, and that is the main advantage of this robotic machines. Now the manual intervention is not there. You can observe by keeping some distance, or with the safe distance you can control this machinery. So there are less chances or less hazards and less risk of the accidents. So we can control this total machinery, total movement of this machinery with the help of this remote by keeping safe distance. That is the main advantage of this robotic. But obviously the cost of this robotic machines are more as compared to the other methods. So these are the different methods of demolitions of the structures. Now what exactly the sequence should be in the demolition operations? So the first step is all cantilever structure shall be demolished first. So whatever the cantilever structures are available in that particular layout, in that structure in the building, that should be demolished first to avoid the accident, to avoid the tilting of that particular building or that structure. Before demolishing roof, all water tanks and lift rooms shall be demolished first. So it is a sequence that you should first demolish the cantilever structure, then you should go for demolishing the water tanks and the lift rooms so that the weight of that particular building can be reduced, and then we can go for the demolishing the roofs. Then the next step is demolition of the floor slab shall begin at mid-span and proceed towards the supporting beams. So this demolition of the floor slab shall begin after the roof or after the water tanks and lift rooms, and it should be started at the mid-span, and then we can go for the other direction, but the from the center you can start the demolition process. The order of demolition of floor beams shall be as follows. So the cantilever beam, then secondary beam, and then primary beam. So other supports or the secondary things should be demolished first, especially when we are talking about the beams. So the cantilever beam is the first priority, then secondary beams, and then primary beam should be demolished. So that is the sequence for demolition of the floor beams. Then next step is non-load bearing walls and partition wall shall be removed prior to demolition process. So non-load bearing walls, where there is no load or the bearings are not required or structured like that only, so that should be demolished. And then some partition, that partition may be a cement partition, that may be a glass partition, that may be a wooden partition, that may be a plastic construction or any other material. So then that partition should be demolished. That is the sequence. Then columns and load bearing wall shall be demolished after removal of the beams on the top. So the last one is columns and load bearing walls. So this is the sequence where you can understand there is some engineering principles. We have to avoid some hazards, we have to avoid the risk, and for that purpose we have to do the demolition in this way only. So that is the specific sequence for the demolition of any type of structures. Then the steps before demolitions. So In the previous slide, we have discussed about how to do the demolitions, what should be the sequence, and before demolition, we have to follow these type of steps. So the first step is surveying, then the removal of hazardous materials, then third step is preparation of plan, then fourth is hazard identification, and then fifth is safety measures. So after doing all these steps, then only we can start the demolition, right? So what exactly these steps are, let us discuss one by one. The first step is surveying. So the survey may be building survey. So in the demolition process, so building survey is the one, then detailed survey, and some other surveys may be included in the survey of demolition method. So in the building survey, you should identify the drawing records. So the building records, building plant layout, then plot layout, some corporation level buildings layouts, and other things should be identified. You should study that drawings, and then only you have to decide how to start the demolition process. Then material survey. So what type of material and in what in which quantity the material is added. So normally in the structure of the material is the cement concretes, some ash, maybe some wooden structures, some metal structures, and some other materials like POP, plastic, etc. can be added in that material. So how much quantity and what type of material is added in that structure, that should be identified in that material survey. Then hazardous material. So you have to identify whether the hazardous material is present in that structure or not. So if the hazardous material is available in that structure, so after demolition process, or if it is possible before demolition process, you have to separate out this hazardous material, and this hazardous material should be treated as per the government's norms or the pollution control norms only. Because for the hazardous waste or the hazardous material, there is a separate site designed by the central or state pollution control board, and that site only that should be treated or controlled, right? So that particular agency which is identified by this government agency, so that hazardous material should be hand over to that particular agency only. Then photographs of building to be demolished. So whatever the photographs of that building, if the photographs of the larger size, then that should be demolished first, and then you can separate out these photographs from that building before demolishing the process. Then surrounding buildings, so you have to identify whether there is a sufficient space is available or not after demolition process, because that the particular shape of building, that height of building decides what exactly and how much space is required after the demolition. Because after demolition process, then that building material is spread out in the surrounding area, that dust is created in the surrounding area, and for controlling all this material, for controlling the dust, we require the space. For that purpose, you have to identify the surroundings of the buildings. If the buildings are located very nearby, which is not sufficient, then we have to change the plan, or we have to adopt the different method of demolition. So depending on the surrounding building, that should be decided. Then building height, distance from the nearby buildings. So I have already discussed these things. And then type of building. So which type of building is that? So whether it is a complete bearing load or non-bearing load, whether it is purely of cement, whether it is a mixture of cement and other waste like ash or some plastic material, that may be some waste material. So whatever the material, whatever the type of building, that should be identified first, and then we can go for the demolition steps. Some other surveys like structural survey should be done. So under this structural survey, the main aim is to find out the structural strength of that particular building. So what is the strength of that building? what is the special structure of that building, what is the behavior of that structure, then what are the structural support systems are incorporated in that structure, what is the degree of deterioration, because some of the buildings are near to the seashore, some of the buildings are in the region where the humidity is more, so the corrosion rate will be high. So due to corrosion, again the deterioration of that building is more, the deterioration of that particular metallic bridge may be more as compared to the other bridges or the other buildings. So depending on that type of material, depending on the weather conditions, the behavior of structure, the special structure and support systems are can be identified with the help of this structural survey. So the main things are the drawing records, because before starting the actual structure or the construction of that building, you can observe these drawing records available with that owner, and on the basis of these drawing records you can identify how to go for the demolition. Then the second step is the removal of hazardous material. So the main hazardous material normally involved in the construction is asbestos, because asbestos are used for insulation purpose, and for that purpose we have to separate out this asbestos or asbestos derivatives material, because the notifiable disease is mentioned under the Factory Act asbestosis. So for avoiding this disease, for avoiding this asbestosis, we have to remove this asbestos from the building structure, and that should be treated under the guidelines of the Central Pollution Control Board with the help of the hazardous waste treatment site. So in the case when asbestos containing material are discovered, specialist contractor shall be employed to remove such asbestos containing material. Then third step is preparation of plan. So based on demolition surveys, a demolition plan is prepared. So on the basis of survey, that may be a structural survey, that may be a building survey, on the basis of survey, on the findings of that survey, we have to plan accordingly. This plan is produced with the application for approval to the local authority. So whatever the plan you are going to design on the basis of these types of survey, you have to approve this plan with the help of local authority. This plan include the location of building to be demolished, then building height, structural system, proposed sequence of demolition steps, and details of the equipments used. So what should be the demolition process, what exactly the sequence of the demolition is, and what is the date and time required to demolish this process, which equipments you are going to use this demolition, and what exactly the location of that building or that structure is. So all this data should be given to the local authority, to the government authority, and then the local authority or government authority is going to approve that particular demolition plan on the basis of your planning or the demolition surveys. Then extent of damage to the building, what exactly the possibilities, what exactly the worst case after this demolition, what the damage to the building, then existing the structures and the facilities in the vicinity. So is there any chances, is there any hazard or the risk for the damage to the facilities available? That facilities may be a corporation garden, that facility may be a gym, that facility may be a open ground, that may be a nearby building or other structures. So whatever the facilities are available in the vicinity of that building or that structure, whether all these facilities are going to damage or not. If it is the case, then what percent or up to what extent that damage to the building is occur, can be occur. Then layout of plan. So we have to check the layout of this plan, then proposed method of demolition, and what are the safety measures you are going to take before the demolitions. So that is the main thing. So before starting the actual demolition, you have to go for this different steps before starting. That is called as pre-planning. And then for the safety measures, we have to take some safety measures or some techniques should be adopted to reduce the risk, to reduce the hazard. Now the fourth step is hazard identification in the demolition work. So falls from height or on the same level. So if the high rise buildings are there, then there is a possibility of falls from height or on the same level can be happen. That is one of the hazard. Then falling debris. So after demolition process, after using the machineries, after using these jaws or crushers or hammers or the wrecking ball method, whatever the method is, if the debris is falling from a particular height, then that may be a hazard. Then premature collapse of the structure being demolished. If you are identified, if you are calculated that this structure or this particular part is going to collapse after this time, but if it is going to collapse before that particular time, then that is called as premature collapse. And that is again a hazard because you are not going to prepare for that collapse. Then dust and fumes. So after demolition process, the demolition method may be any type of method, but dust is going to form. Some fumes may be formed because in some of the structure, you have to go for hammering process. You have to go for some cutting process. You have to go for some striking process, etc. Due to these methods, due to these operations, the dust due to the cement and some of the fumes may be due to some operations can be formed. So that is again another hazard. The silting up of drainage systems by dust. So there is a chances of choke up of this drainage system due to dust. So you have to close all these drainage systems carefully to avoid this type of choke up of these drainage systems or other systems if it is available in the vicinity of that building or structure. Then the problems arising from the spilled fuel oils. So there are chances of splitting up or leakages or spilling of the fuel oils if available in that premises or available in that structure or in that building. Then manual handling. So manual handling may be a hazardous process, and that is one of the hazard. So that is why nowadays we are going to adopt the different methods, like with the help of machines, with the help of some hydraulic crushers or the robotics things can be used. But in some of the cases, if the building is collapsed accidentally, then we have to adopt the manual handling process. So that may be a hazard. Then presence of asbestos and other hazardous substances. So there are different hazardous material which may be present in that building, in that structure, and the list of hazardous substances are given in the Factory Act and schedule, and the diseases may be, that is called as notifiable diseases, may be happen, may be occur due to this presence of this material, and that should be identified before the demolition work. So asbestos is one of the hazardous material, but other hazardous material may be present in that building. So these are the different hazards present in the demolition work. Then noise and vibration from heavy plant and equipment. Suppose you are going to use the equipment, you are going to use the machinery, you are going to use some robotic machines, you are going to use some hammering techniques. So that may be a machine hammering, that may be a manual hammering, whatever it may be. But all these things are going to create a noise. So noise and vibrations are the major hazards in that demolition work. Then some electric shock is the another hazard, is the possibility, because we are going to use electric supply for operating these type of machineries. Then fires and explosions from fires and explosions from the use of flammable and explosive substances. So there are chances of fires if the fuel are present in the structure. If there is a nitrogen derivatives materials are present in that particular structure or the building, then there are chances of explosion also. then smoke from the burning west timber. So if the wood or wooden like structures, or it is also called as hydrocarbons, or the combustible materials are present in that structure or building, then there are chances of burning of this material that may be a part of that building, that may be a part of west. So whatever it may be, but if that material is combustible, then there are chances of fire and there are chances of smoke. Then pneumatic drills and power tools are going to be used, because normally the demolition is processed by the machineries. That is why we have to use this power tools or the drills. So that create again the noise and vibration, and there are again the chances of electric shocks. The existence of services such as electricity, gas and water. That is one of the hazard where we are using this electricity, gases and water. Because in some cases, if the dust is more, if the dust is creating the explosion type, then we have to spray the water in that particular area where we are using the ball and rack arrangement, or we are going to strike that particular wall, then for that part we have to spray that water to avoid the dust, to settle that dust. Then collision with heavy plant, so there are chances of collisions with other plants, with other heavy plants. That is one of the hazard. And the plant and vehicles overturning. So if more than one machineries are available to demolish that site, then there are chances of overturning for these vehicles, and this is again one of the hazard, because this due to noise generation, due to vibration generations, there are less chances to hear a particular guidance, a particular voice or sound in that area, and due to that particular noise, that vehicles overturning as well as the chances of accidents may be there. So these are the different hazards can be identified in the demolition work. Some other health hazards, so the previous hazards may be of noise hazard, that may be a mechanical hazard, that may be a physical hazard, that may be a fire hazard, explosion hazards, electric hazards, etc. Now these hazards are related to the health. So in the health hazard, that may be related to the skin. So cement enzema due to alkalinity or presence of chromium, furnaces, pyoderma, cellulitis, asbestosis, etc. can be occur. So these are the different diseases can be occur, which is related to the skin as well as which is related to the some of the pulmonary systems, because this asbestosis also related to the pulmonary systems, and this asbestosis mainly called is the pulmonary disease. So due to the material present in that particular structure, due to that material, skin diseases may occur. In some cases, some vision hazards, that is conjunctivitis, may be happen, maybe due to dust, maybe due to some materials throwing out. Then nervous systems, muscular pain if you are going to demolish the structure manually, or if you are going to demolish the structure with the help of machine. But if you are going to work overtime and with a wrong gesture or posture, then there are chances of muscular pains, back pain, then neuralgia, then spondylosis, arthritis, rheumatisms, etc. can be occur. So depending on the type of work, depending on the method of demolition, and depending of your gesture and posture, can be happen. So peptic, so some of the dust, the other materials can be inhaled by you, some of the materials can be digested by you. So that are the chances where the digestive systems can be attacked by this foreign material or impurities present at that site. Then due to the noise and vibration, hearing losses are the one of the health hazard, where the temporary hearing loss or the threshold shift may be there, or in some cases if you are going to work continuously more than 8 hours for more than the maximum permissible limit, then there are chances of permanent threshold shift. Then some other health hazards like radiant heat, then high temperature near furnace, then CO gas, that is carbon monoxide, asbestosis due to asbestos cement products, etc. So in all these health hazard, asbestosis is main the focus. So the material asbestos, if it is in the suspension form, and if you are going to inhale that particular respirable suspended particular material as asbestos, then there are chances of this asbestos going toward the lungs, and if that is deposited in the lungs, then it is called as asbestosis. So due to this asbestos material present in the lung systems, your breathing capacity is going to reduce, and if it is the continuous process, then there are chances of fatality due to the lung damage systems. That is why asbestos is banned in most of the countries. So these are the different hazards that should be identified before the demolition work. Then the fifth step is the safety measures or the controls. So we know the hierarchy of control, that if it is possible, then you should go for the elimination. Suppose if there is a structure, and for that structure there are chances of risk, there are chances of some hazards, then you are going to, that should be eliminated by some of the method. So physically removal of that hazard is nothing but the elimination. If the elimination is not possible, then you should go for the substitution method. So substitution of this hazardous material, substitution of this hazardous method, that is nothing but the replacement of this hazard. So for example, if carbon monoxide is there, then carbon monoxide gas is hazardous than the carbon dioxide. Then carbon dioxide is also a pollutant, but as compared to the carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide is a less hazardous. So this is one of the example where you have to burn this carbon monoxide, and then that CO is going to convert into CO2, right? So instead of CO, now the CO2 is present. That is nothing but the replacement or the substitution. If elimination and substitution is not possible, then you can go for the engineering control. So with the help of some technology, with the help of some modification in the methods, with the help of some latest tools, you can use this engineering control as a hazard control technique or as a safety measures. That is, isolate the people from the hazards. So if it is possible to separate out, to keep distance, to isolate the things from the particular hazard, then that is nothing but the engineering control. Then there are different examples of this engineering controls are there. You can identify the engineering control method, substitution method, elimination method at your site. Then administrative controls. So if there are chances, or if some of the people are not going to control all these activities, or confused, or not having some presence of mind, then you have to change that particular people work, or you are going to change or replace that particular person with that particular task. If someone is not going to control the dust by spraying the water in a proper method, in an appropriate method, then you have to change the work of that particular person, and you have to place expert persons at that place. And likewise, you have to change the way of the people work, or you have to change the people's place, or you have to change the people's work. That is called as administrative control. And if all these methods, that is elimination, substitution, engineering control, and administrative controls, are not feasible at your site, then you have to adopt the personal protective equipment. Means you can't eliminate the hazard, you can't substitute the hazard, you can't control or isolate this hazard with the engineering control, or if you can't change the way or the people's work, then you have to adopt the personal protective equipment. So please mind it that personal protective equipment is the last option in the hierarchy of control in the safety measures, right? So to protect the worker, you have to use the hard hats, helmets, safety harness systems, or if it is needed, then electric shock proof soles or that shoes. Then you have to adopt some dust mask or maybe air purified respirator, etc. at that site of the demolitions. So depending on the requirement, you have to go for this personal protective equipment. So for the protection of the worker, we should adopt its hierarchy of control. That is nothing but the safety measures. Then for controlling or for training some of the behavioral aspects, we have to go for the training and communication, because some people are new for this demolition process, some people are experienced one, but they may be lacking in some of the skills operation in the demolition process. So for that purpose, for that requirement, we have to go for the training and communication. So demolition workers, including plant or equipment operators, shall go through the proper job safety training and be informed of the potential hazards by attending training sessions as well as on the job training. Because in the demolition process, on the job training is most important as compared to the theoretical or the hall training sessions, right? So you should feel what exactly the conditions are there, then what are the chances, what are the worst conditions, and for that identification, you should go for the on-the-job training. And each and every person on the site should communicate it that what are the steps you are going to follow, what are the steps of the demolitions are, and how to control these hazards. So all these things should be, or the detail plan should be communicated to each and every worker. Then the equipment maintenance. So whatever the equipments you are going to use at that site, that should be tested, that should be examined by the standard process. Normally, we must go for the highest standards process, and then they shall be properly stored and maintained even during or after the demolition process. The equipment shall be inspected daily, and results of the inspection shall be recorded accordingly. So all these are nothing but the maintenance steps of these equipments. Then electrical safety is one of the controlling measures. A properly connected power source from a local electric utility supplier or a mobile electricity generator shall be utilized in the demolition sites. So that connectivity, the power source, that all things should be checked, and then only we have to use this electrical power supply. Then fire safety, all flammable goods shall be removed from the site unless they are necessary for the works involved. So if some combustible materials are available at that site, you have to isolate that fuel, because we know that for the fire triangle, for the fire, isolation is one of the method. If you are going to isolate that fuel, then there are less chances of fire. Any remaining flammable goods should be stored in a proper storage facilities. So if some goods or some fuel is required for the demolition process itself, then you have to store it properly and should follow the safe and standard operating procedures to utilize these fuels. Then vibration is one of the aspect. Demolition work will cause vibration to neighboring buildings or structure to various extent, depending on the method of demolition, which should be controlled by suitable monitoring. The most serious vibration is caused by the implosion. So implosion is the phenomena where we are using the explosive material, and due to the detonation process, because in the detonation, the wave which is generated in that implosion or the explosion is near about sound wave or more than the sound wave velocity. And that is why it creates a vibration, and that vibration may damage to the people or the structures or the buildings near the vicinity of that particular structure which is going to demolish. So while implosion, you have to take more care for this noise and vibration. Then air pollution is the case for all types of methods, because dust is going to create. Concrete breaking, handling of debris, and hauling process are main sources of dust from building demolition. Dust mitigation measures such as water spraying shall be adopted to minimize the dust emissions. Burning of waste shall not be allowed. So this is one of the main or the commonest technique where we are going to spray the water for that particular point or for that structure to avoid the suspension of the dust. So for the settling of the dust, we have to spray the sufficient amount of water at that structural site. Then diesel fumes generated by a mechanical plant or equipment shall be controlled. So if you are going to use the DG set or some other equipments or machinery which are used the diesel as a fuel, then you have to control these diesel fumes. Then controlling air pollution by spraying water. So this picture you can observe that for this particular point, now we have to spray this water with the help of water hose, and so that this dust can be settled down. Then for noise pollution, we already discussed that noise is going to generate because we are using some of the equipment, some of the principles which can generate a noise. So pneumatic breakers, excavators and generators, loading and transportation of debris, that is vehicles we are going to use, that affects the worker and the sensitive receivers in the vicinity of the demolition sites. So we can't avoid all these things, or we can't reduce a noise at a particular level at the demolition site. And for that purpose, we have to adopt the person protective equipment as a one of the method of safety measure. So using of ear plug or ear defender or ear muffs for avoiding the noise pollution. So we can use this type of PP to reduce the adverse effect on the ear. So you can observe this picture of the ear muff. Then this person wearing this PP like hard hats, ear muffs, hand gloves, safety shoes, etc. Then in some of the structure, we have to use protective screen. So if some high rise buildings are there or some complicated structures are there, and for the demolition purpose, we have to use this protective screen. So from this picture itself, you can observe how these protective screens are going to protect the particular damage of the material or damage to the people. So the flying or falling object is one of the hazard. So for that purpose, we can use this protective screen. Then by using this PP, you can avoid the physical, mental and health hazard. Use of hard hats, gloves, safety shoes, glasses, jackets, earplugs, etc. is the compulsory for the demolition process. Then we have to use some safety signs or the symbols at that site. Safety signs must be there to aware the workmen and public near the site, because some unknown persons or some workmen who were not present for the induction training or some urgent replacement may be there. So for that purpose, these signs are helpful, useful to aware the activities nearby this demolition site. So you can observe the some of the symbols like foot protection must be worn, and safety helmets must be worn. No authorized person allowed on this site. Then high visibility jackets must be worn. Then parents should be warn children of potential hazards. Some danger or precautions symbols may be there at that site. Then these are the some of the examples where the hazards are there. Then who is going to harm or what is going to harm? that should be mentioned in the second column, and how to avoid, how to control, or what precautions should be taken to avoid this type of hazard, to control this type of hazard. So these are some of the examples for this demolition site. One of the example is public entering site. So some public, for the enthusiasm, for saying how to demolish this structure, for that purpose some public is going to enter at that demolition site. So who is going to harm? Injuries to the persons. So person is who is going to enter at that site is going to harm. The site must be securely fenced off and locked at the end of working day. Signage warning of danger should be displayed at the site or at the fence systems. So that is the major. So this is the activity, this is the hazard, who is going to hazard or what is going to hazard, and what is the solution or the remedy for that particular hazard to avoid. Then gases or electricity, so some explosions, fire chances, and some shocks. So if electricity is there, then electrical shocks are possibilities. Then if some combustible gases, some explosive gases are there, then there are chances of fire and explosions. So these are the hazard or what is going to happen. Then what is the remedy or the solution? Services to be disconnected and confirmed to be disconnected by a licensed persons. So you can use LOTO system, that is lockout and tagout system also. So before starting any type of operations which is dangerous or which requires the work permit, then you should go for the work permit systems or the lockout tagout systems to avoid this type of hazards. So the energy isolation or elimination of energy is the main solution for this type of hazard. Then working at height or fall from height, injury to the person. So depending on the height, depending on the fall type, that injuries may be a serious injury, that may be a non-serious injury, or that may be a fatality case. Then the solution is use of scaffolding, use of fall arrest systems are the main solutions. So if you are going to use the scaffolding, then there are less chances, because on the scaffolding there is arrangement of platform system, there is arrangement of barricading system, there is arrangement of fencing systems, some bars are arranged, and safety harness is essential for the scaffolding. So there are less hazard or less risk at the scaffolding. If the scaffolding is not feasible for that particular site, for that particular work, then you should go for the fall arrestor systems. So nowadays there is a latest fall arrestor systems which can avoid you to fall from a particular height, and in case if you are going to fall, then some shock absorbing systems are incorporated in that fall arrestor systems. So avoiding any type of damage to your body parts, this fall arrestor system can work. Then road users and pedestrians during movement of lorries. So when we are demolishing this structure, there are chances of creating some debris. So to transport these debris, to transport some hazardous material, to transport some useful material, recyclable material, whatever it may be, lorries or the movement of lorries is there. So in case if some road users or pedestrians are entering at that site or near the site, then there are chances of injuries to that persons. Then what is the solution? Use of banksmen at all times, warning signs and physical barrier should be placed at that site and near the site. Then general site hazards like dust and cuts. So these are the types of hazards. So injury to the person. So depending on the type of hazard, that may be a dust, that may be a cut. So use of personal protective equipment at all times, that is one of the solution. Dust suppression systems. Then plan full site coverage of water mist when required. So you have to use dust mask. If dust mask is not sufficient, then you are going to use the full body protection mask with air respiratory systems, and if it is possible to spray the water at all time on the site, then that is again useful because it settle down the dust, and if the suspension of that dust is avoided, then the respirable suspended particular matter which can go inside the pulmonary system is going to avoid. So these are the different solution for this dust. Then there are chances of cuts. So in some of the operations, while hammering, while cutting some of the metals, while cutting the walls or some other materials, so there are chances of cuts. So you have to wear the cut resistance personal protective equipment. That cut resistance, hand gloves, etc. are available. So you have to wear this cut resistance hand gloves to avoid the cut type of hazard. The manual handling. So when we are going to adopt the manual demolition process, or if some operations are there which they are going to handle manually, then there are chances of injury to that persons. So all times to be checked before manual lifting. So that attendant person should be take care of all these manual lifting, manual handling, manual operations to avoid the injuries. So on the basis of this discussion, we can conclude that demolition is the most dangerous or hazardous activity as compared to the other civil activities. Demolition must be well planned to avoid the fatalities and the injuries. Development in techniques allows rapid demolition. It can be concluded that demolishing or imploding the building structure will prove very useful, economical, and quickest for reconstruction. Leads to a safe and controlled demolition for the occupants and neighborhood with no harm to the environment. So we have to take care of the neighborhood. We have to take care of the different sites or the facilities which are already available in the vicinity of that particular structure. So before starting the reconstruction activity, for reconstruction activity we should go for the demolition, but that demolition method should be adopted on the basis of different types of surveys and the expertise results or conclusions.